the price of the coins and tokens does not reflect the value of the project as much as it does the stocks, right?
Yes.
I mean, I guess you have some examples, like with Tesla going up so much as a stock, people, I mean, even Elon Musk himself said, I think it's too high, and then you saw the price go down again. But yeah, in general, stocks do reflect how the business does, because you have earnings reports, you have all these kind of fundamental aspects that come out, investors see that, and they're like, okay, I'm going to put some money into this.
This is undervalued. But
with cryptocurrency, it doesn't seem to be like that at all. It seems like people will come out with news article after news article saying, look at all this cool stuff we're doing, and it's really good stuff. No one cares. Why not?
You make a good point there. I mean, you know, as you said, you know, cryptocurrency companies will release, you know, their quarterly returns, and that does nothing much to the price compared to if it were, you know, Tesla stock or Apple stock, and how that can be a misconception of saying this is a large number, therefore this is good.
Yeah.
You know, so it is trying to separate the two together.
Picture your favorite crypto app or exchange. Got it? Now I have 5 questions for you. Question number 1, does your favorite app or exchange have fiat on and off ramps that do not charge you crazy fees? Question number 2, does your app actually help you time your investments with machine learning and algorithms? Question number 3, does your app or favorite exchange connect to multiple exchanges to get you best rates, best liquidity, but also mitigate the risk of a central failure of one single order book? Question number 4, is your favorite app or exchange Swiss made, but also licensed and regulated in the EU so that you can feel 100% reassured, but also sleep well at night? Question number 5, is your favorite app or exchange fully aligned with your principles and values, 100% community centric and not VC backed? So if your answer to any of these questions is a no, what are you waiting for? Download the Swissborg Wealth app, join the new era of wealth management, and enjoy the ride.
Dear crypto community, blockchain buddies across the globe, welcome back to Cryptonites, the no BS blockchain channel built with the community and for the community. And we're here, season 3 finale, with another mind-blowing guests with an S. We have 2 people for the price of 1. Really excited to have one of the most trending YouTube crypto channels in this space, CryptoBusy, which was also voted as top 10 most trusted crypto YouTube channels by Bitcoin Trade Board. Really excited to have both Josh and Tom, gentlemen. A real pleasure, guys.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
So first off, guys, your story. You just mentioned something about how long you knew each other. It's a beautiful narrative. Please share it with us.
So, you know, we've known each other since, I'd say, 2 or 3 years old. Born in the same hospital. It's been, ever since then, it's just been absolutely crazy.
20 years of friendship turned into a business, I guess. Yeah. I mean, we'd already always had that kind of entrepreneurship spirit.
And mindset.
And, turned it into something.
Yeah.
That's so cool, guys, to see you guys so close and still working with each other, from babies to businessmen, right? It's a really nice narrative. And there's another thing that's really cool is you both became FX traders, right? And then transitioned into crypto. And this is really fascinating because I was in Japan for the past 12 years and most of the crypto crowd actually started in FX. So it's a really fascinating transition. Could you tell us a little bit more about this?
Sure. Yeah, sure. So about 5 years ago, now, so when we were about 17, that's when we, I guess, got interest in FX and just finance in general, really. We'd always been, I guess, the uni student money hungry. So we were trying to find ways to earn money, and we heard about trading and we thought, well, that seems easy enough. It wasn't. We lost a lot of money to start with, definitely, but it was you know, after maybe a year of good practice, good discipline, finding the right places and going through the right education, I think we just about became profitable. And then since then we've been doing it. And it's kind of one of those things that is just so fun now to me, kind of addicted to doing it. So every day I pretty much trade. So.
And for myself, I mean, you know, always interested in numbers, looking at charts. I mean, you know, I can remember when I was 12 years old, looking at my iPod stocks app, you know, and seeing, well, oh, Apple's been up. And so, you know, had that interest in the idea of how, you know, things go up and down. And so when we looked into Forex, it was just pretty much what we always wanted to do. So going Definitely. From that and flowing that into crypto itself, it's been absolutely amazing. Sure. Yeah.
It's funny because every talented trader has that I've lost all my money in the beginning type story.
Yeah. Yeah.
But are those kind of like the best experiences or the most learning? Not best in terms of, I don't have any money to go out tonight or into the pub.
Yeah, yeah, I can remember a time back in, I think, 2017, 2018, I was just trading purely on the news. And that was a big, big mistake for myself. You know, and that's when I started to take into account technical analysis. So fundamental analysis and technical analysis itself and putting the two together. So that was a big lesson for me because I lost a fair bit then.
Yeah, but, I think it's risk management is always key across wherever you trade, invest, anything. You always got to limit the risk. And that's what helped me. And I think I put maybe £500 in the first trading account. And to me at the time, that was tons of money because I wasn't really making any. I lost it all within maybe 2 months. And that was just, it was a pretty bad experience for me. And that shook me up so much. It was such a lot of money to me at the time. I just had to take a step away and kind of focus on learning rather than doing. I think I jumped in way too quickly and it really taught me how to manage my risk and actually go out there and learn how to do it properly rather than just trying to get rich quick.
But also continuously learning. You know, it's a continuous learning exercise.
Getting better every day, definitely. Yeah. That's why it's fun, because there's never a standstill moment, really.
It's like a journey rather than end goal, exactly. Right? Yeah. Because you always need to adapt.
And every week the market's different. Yeah, it's ever changing. Yeah. Yeah. Especially in crypto now as well. You can barely predict that at all. So that's, but it's interesting kind of bringing FX to crypto because there is that similarity there, but at the same time, it's a wildly different world because I feel like fundamentals play a massive part in crypto, whereas maybe they don't as much in FX. I mean, you do still have some kind of black swan events, but in general, you do have a lot of these crazy news releases in crypto that just drive the price up hundreds of percent, which that just doesn't really happen in other markets.
Yeah, definitely.
Or at least not to the same extent.
That's fascinating. So you kind of understood about, you know, buy the rumor and sell the news kind of thing rather than just buying the news, which a lot of people, they just watch CNBC, you know, Cramer, you know, just buy this stock, it's hot. And everyone buys it at the wrong time that. But is that one of the main lessons that you learned by making mistakes in the beginning?
Yeah, it was. Tom? And I learned from that. And, you know, again, it's a continual learning process, but, you know, it's not buying the news at the top or buying at the top itself. It's, you know, looking and really doing a lot of analysis and deep dives into different crypto projects and seeing where things can go. So, you know, we look at the team, we look at the technology that they have, is it being adopted, and does it have a real world use case? And those are the key points that we look into to see what a project can do.
I mean, I've said on many of the times on the channel, we have like a checklist that we literally religiously follow before we get into any project. It has to match at least kind of 5 out of the 7 criteria, whatever it is. Mm-hmm. And as well as that, you know, we've tried and pinpoint our entry with technical analysis. So they do go hand in hand, as you said, rather than focusing on one or the other, you know.
Yeah. Looking at the white paper or sometimes the light paper if you don't have time to read the white paper itself. But it's things like that as well, so.
It's a lot of work, right? It's a lot of research, a lot of due diligence. It's not easy, right?
Yeah, that's why I think a lot of people think they can just come in and, well, what we did to start with, come in and just think we can suddenly make millions, even though that's just not how it works, unfortunately.
It takes time.
But it is good experience, I think, especially when we had that bear market in 2018, 2019. It flushed out a lot of weak hands. And I think now we're left with some people that kind of know a bit more about what it's like to go through this and that things will recover, things will get better as long as you just hold through the pain.
And fundamentally actually believe in the projects that they're investing
exactly.
in and things like that as well.
Yeah,
it's so true. I just had Scott on the show last week and he was saying, he quoted Warren Buffett, which says, you know, the stock market is a medium that transfers money from the unpatient to the patient, impatient to the patient. Yeah, so
definitely.
Is that kind of what you guys learned as well through the crypto
I feel the people that end up losing money are the people that jump on each pump every day or whatever. Like they just try find the next big thing rather than like, I think where we've gone right, especially in the last couple of years, is we've just picked good solid projects and we just held throughout. I mean, we got lucky. Our first investment was XRP back at 2 cents. And then we sold at $3.20. So that was our kind of, that's what got us into it. Used that money, diversified a bit. And then, yeah, that kind of spurred us on and gave us that love and hunger for
those the tears of redemption.
Exactly.
The channel itself, I mean, CryptoBusy, you know, we've always wanted to create a YouTube channel. We've always been interested in filmmaking itself. And to see this, to see us investing and saying, well, okay, this is something that we can do here. And so it was back in March of 2018 that we actually created the CryptoBusy channel. And I remember going to a crypto convention and we're telling other people to subscribe to our channel.
We had three subscribers, my mom, you and me.
It's crazy.
But, no, definitely. Yeah. No. And I think anyone that knows me as well would know, well, they, if they haven't seen me in a few years, they'd be like, well, what was he doing in finance? Because I was literally studying English literature. I was going to be like a journalist or a marketing person, but I just found love through cryptocurrency and Forex. And through there, I just kind of did a full 360 on a 180 even on everything.
That's fascinating. I want to ask you a follow-up question based on risk management. You mentioned that a little bit earlier, Josh, in terms of lesson learned. Are you talking about stop losses or what are some of the measures that through the mistakes you knew, you kind of thought, okay, this is what I want to do to manage my risk?
I mean, it kind of depends on the way you're trading. I mean, with Forex, like, set a stop loss at every trade. You just have to.
If you don't,
you are just asking for it. Because
and you have to be religious about it.
Pick a level and stick to that. Do not move it. Like, once you start moving your stop loss, you're just asking for more and more losses. Don't ever average into your losses. Like, just leave the trade how it is. However, with crypto, I found it's a little bit different. At first, I was doing it the same way I was doing Forex. I was saying, got to set a stop loss, take profit, don't adjust anything. But now I feel like stop losses, I kind of pick and choose when I use them now, because a lot of the time with all the volatility, you'll see the price come down, touch the loss, and then shoot back up. So I find you need more room to breathe. And because I believe in a lot of these projects that I trade fundamentally, sometimes I'm more okay with allowing me to be in a bit of drawdown, because I know, or at least I think in my mind, that it's going to go up eventually. So for me, one of the key things is I only really like to trade coins that I know about. You know, I don't just trade any coin. I like to make sure I know the project and I actually most of the time believe in the project, because let's say my trade's not going in the right direction, I'm not panicking and I'm not going to sell it for a loss, because in my head I think, well, give it a little bit of time and I'll be in profit again. It is nice to get in and out on small scalping trades, but in general I would say do research on the project before you trade on it, you know.
Please add.
Myself, I mean, you know, again, with Forex, you got to set the stop losses.
Yeah.
With crypto, again, you know, it's finding that balance. Personally for myself, I haven't, you know, set a stop loss, because I'm looking at it more of a long-term perspective. Yes, you could set a stop loss, but at the end of the day, it's sort of having a macro perspective, a long-term view about where things could go. I'm not holding, you know, the cryptos I'm holding for the next week. I'm holding it for the next year, next 2 years, 5 years. So, you know, it's really taking a long-term perspective about it as well. I'm doing dollar cost averaging as well.
That's a big thing. And I think definitely, people now think that they're too late, and I think that's a massive problem, misconception, because in reality I think it was something like 99% of people don't even know about cryptocurrency. So we really have to take the approach that we're actually really early into it, and, you know, we could potentially see rapid growth. I mean, the people that got into Bitcoin at $10, a lot of them probably sold at $20 thinking, wow, that's 2x on my money, and now they're probably crying because
it's only the guy who bought pizza. With Bitcoin itself, he certainly
paid, you know, what, however many Bitcoin it was. It's worth like 100 million now, most expensive pizza ever, like, but it's definitely, risk management is key, but we also have to take the approach, especially in cryptocurrency, in my opinion, if you believe in it long term, don't get too caught up with having really small and tight stop losses in your trades if you're planning on holding them for a longer time. If you're doing short-term trades, then it is still wise to have a stop loss.
Thank you so much for that, gents. And that's a perfect transition to the next question, which is, we were talking about fundamental analysis, technical analysis, but you guys on CryptoBusy, you have a really new approach, which is social sentiment.
Yeah.
And I talked to a really well-respected trader the other day, Matty Greenspan, who's saying social sentiment could be more valuable than technical analysis in the future at one point, possibly depending on how much data we can get. But could you please tell us a little bit about fundamental analysis, technical, and the social sentiment that you guys use?
Well, as I said earlier, you know, they do go hand in hand, the technical analysis and the fundamental analysis. And I think back in March or April of this year, we started using Luna Crush, which has the social sentiment as well. And this is a new angle at where things could go, and a statistic where you know, the cryptocurrency is. So, for example, you know, you look at the social sentiment of Ethereum. A lot of people are talking about it, but there will be also, you know, things like VeChain and XRP, Zilliqa. You look at the social sentiment and it's pretty much, you know, how many people are talking about it, the social volume. You know, we're looking at, is it being talked about on Twitter, on YouTube itself, and that does play into hand yeah. that. You know, if a coin is being put onto a new exchange, that, you know, people, that'll make people talk about the coin a bit more. So it's a fundamental thing, but it's also taking everything into account. You can't just take one statistic and extrapolate that. No, you have to, you know, come to your own conclusion with the wide options that you have and the wide,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah, and I think jumping on the back of that as well, with using technicals and social sentiment myself, it's massive, especially in crypto. Because let's say you're using some, you know, classic trading strategies, using support, resistance or whatever, using trend lines. You don't know if the level's ever going to be respected. You never know in Forex, in stocks, in cryptocurrency. But one thing that can help in cryptocurrency is if you see what the social sentiment is around those levels. So let's say price is coming to a very key area of support. Well, how do we know that area is going to hold? Well, are there a lot of people watching that area? And how would we know that? Well, maybe a lot of people tweeting saying this coin's coming to a key level, or maybe there's just a lot of buyers with buy orders coming in at that point. You can generally get a good sense for it. And I feel like that's what crypto has a little bit of an edge over maybe Forex, is there's not that kind of place to go for social sentiment.
Yeah. You know, you scroll through Twitter, you type in, you know, Ripple or Bitcoin or VeChain, so many people have got analysis and their own ways on talking about this coin itself. So that does play into the social sentiment, and that does help a lot. So it's been a great feature, and something that's been
definitely
really
recommend.
Beneficial.
Yeah, Lunar Crushes.
How accurate was it so far? So you've guys been playing with Lunar Crush for a few months now
already,
right?
Yeah, a few months. I think we randomly found it. No one showed it to us. We literally just typed on Google because we thought, wouldn't it be great if there was some way to kind of have like a collective of all the social sentiment? And then we found Lunar Crush, and we just started using it. And we found, I mean, in terms of accuracy, that you still can't predict prices or like targets based on social, but it's just a good kind of extra added layer of confluence. And I think that's where, so you can't really judge the accuracy completely, but it's definitely increased accuracy of trades already, because like I said before, you can get that extra layer of confluence.
And it's kind of like one of those boxes of the seven criteria, right?
Exactly.
It's just a little check on one of the
definitely
criteria.
Definitely. I think having a systematic approach is like the best way to go about trading. I think if you do it discretionally, you don't know what's going to happen, and you might start adjusting your stop loss, your take profit. You might jump into trades you shouldn't be taking. I have a list of rules, and they'll be on a whiteboard next to me every time I sit down to trade, especially in Forex. And I do it so systematically. If it does not check every single one of those boxes, I'm not taking that trade, because I've been in a position where I've done that and then it loses, and you get really angry at yourself. You're like, oh, why did I take that? I shouldn't have taken that. So I've started setting up like a penalty. So like every time I take a trade and it doesn't follow my rules, even if the trade wins, if it didn't follow my rules, then I've got to, like, I don't know, go out and donate £10 or something like that. I don't know.
Dance in your boxers and under the ring.
Exactly. But also with trading itself, I mean, a lot of it is the mental aspect that goes behind it. Because, you know, if you tie emotion to it, you know, then that is going to, you know, really distort you. So it's also having a level mindset about it and being quite ruthless in some occasions about it. So, you know, being religious in terms of your checklist, and also, you know, going through lessons of, like, you know, what I did, you know, back in 2017 with the trades that we've also made in the past. So it's learning from your mistakes and sometimes readjusting your formula. So again, it's ever changing. And you, if you take that, and if you understand it and take it from that perspective, then, you know, in my eyes, you'll be successful.
Yeah.
That's really cool. And, you know, in terms of how you diversify your portfolio, gents, you know, in terms of crypto, right? You're talking about long views, those you believe, the projects that have real tokenomics, maybe real fundamentals, real utility. But, you know, some of the most speculative coins that literally cannot do anything have that crazy hype and go up 100, 200, 300%.
So, I mean, you know, in my portfolio, I'd also say your portfolio as well, is built up of just around 40% Bitcoin. And that is just so, there's risk management involved there, because, you know, Bitcoin is
stabilized.
And then there are other projects out there that are lower cap, higher risk, but, you know, we look at the project behind it and think, okay, something can be done here. But it's, you know, looking into the top 10, top 100 coins that are out there on the market, and then beyond, and also just looking what can be done. So it is sometimes also looking at the lower cap, higher risk coins, and that's how you diversify. In my opinion, I think that's how you diversify and make a success of it. Because if you just go all in on one coin, then you're only bound to that one coin. If you diversify a bit, and some people disagree or agree on the idea of diversification, I think, you know, if you just want to make sure that everything is stable over a longer period of time and build wealth over a longer period of time, I do think diversifying into different areas, into different cryptocurrencies itself, will help you in the long term.
Definitely. No, diversification is definitely key. I think putting all your eggs in one basket is just a big no-no, especially in something as volatile as cryptocurrency. And also what I think people need to realize a bit more is that everyone comes into crypto with the hopes of making 10,000% or whatever. Like, if we compare this to any other market, a 5-10% gain is amazing, right? So I mean, I think because we've come from other markets and we've come into cryptocurrency, we still have that grounded approach. So like, at the end of the day, if I'm not getting 100%, I don't really care, because I might get 20%. And to me, that's incredible, because obviously it depends on how much money you have invested, if that's a lot, if that's not a lot. But if you've got a good amount in, 10%, 20%, that's beating what you'd get from an index fund. That's way more than you get in 1% from a bank, if you're lucky. So, you know, I think people also have to be a bit more grounded on the approach and what they're actually trying to achieve. I think you need to realize, hang on, you may have made 20%, that's still pretty good. I'm not saying you should cash it all out, but that's a pretty good gain. Like, remember that, you know.
But also, what is promising is to see how the different markets do, how the different asset classes do. I mean, you know, you take precious metals and how they are correlated with Bitcoin, or Bitcoin is correlated with precious metals. So you look at gold, and the price action of gold is fairly similar to the price action of Bitcoin. And that, for me, is quite promising to see that, because, you know, gold is always that sort of safe haven asset. If you look at price of gold back in 2008, the last financial crisis, it went up to, I think, $2,000 or something like that. But, you know, the correlation of, because of the safe haven, but if you look at what Bitcoin is doing, there are similarities there. And that, for me, is promising, because that shows that there is stability in that sense there. So
that's really cool. So you guys mentioned, you know, Bitcoin 40% of your portfolio. In terms of like the other asset classes or sub asset classes, you know, exchange tokens, DeFi tokens, maybe lending tokens, there's so many out there, proof of stake tokens. What are some other asset classes or sub asset classes that you guys are really into these days?
No, for me, I'd say, I mean, I'm big on proof of stake, because I think the whole idea of passive income is just, it's a no-brainer. Like, if I'm going to hold these coins anyway for a long time, why not get paid extra to do it? So I think finding those coins that you do believe on, that you do believe in, and you think are going to do well anyway, well, why not accumulate some more for just holding them? So I think that is like one of the best things, and I try to get into as many proof of stake coins that I actually believe in as possible. That being said, I also think exchange coins are super undervalued, because at the end of the day, where do we have to buy crypto from? Exchanges. Yeah. We wouldn't be able to buy crypto basically without exchanges. So I feel like a lot of these, you know, not necessarily worse exchanges, but lower cap exchanges, or, you know, less volume, they're actually very undervalued. I think you've got some out there, you've got KuCoin, which is obviously a big one, but I think it is undervalued in general, especially their token. I think it's around a dollar or something. I mean, it's been way higher than that before. You've got Binance Coin, of course. I think Binance will most likely stick at number one for a while. And you've got some of these even smaller, you've got like Buybox token or Bbox. You've got other coins, Bancor. You've got these new decentralized ones as well. So I think kind of maybe building a smaller portfolio of these sub-asset classes, as you said, would be a good idea to kind of maybe put a certain amount of risk into this asset class, certain amount of risk into this asset class, and so on and so forth, so you're not spreading yourself too thin, but also you're not putting too much in one asset class.
That's really good, yeah, because like you said, the exchange tokens, in terms of fundamentals, they really check all the boxes.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
I think another big thing as well is also crypto cards. You know, that's for me, and that's bringing crypto to the masses right there. And that's the thing, that's, you know, one major thing that we need to get to, is to bring Bitcoin and cryptocurrency to the masses.
Mass adoption.
And yeah, to see mass adoption and people, you know, really using their cryptocurrency, because at the moment we're just trading or holding it and everything like that. But to actually get real use case of that's great to see. Another thing as well, you know, if you look at it from a macro perspective, a lot of people in the world are unbanked. You know, I think it's something, you know, parts of South America, parts of Africa, parts of Southeast Asia, you know, a lot of these people are unbanked. And if you look at it from the perspective of that, crypto, this is this new asset class. We're about to enter the fourth industrial revolution, where we've got AI, machine learning, blockchain, crypto, to really harness these technologies. Will, in my opinion, will bring humanity to the next level. Yeah. It will lift people, will lift a lot of people out of poverty. So to see and meet and people like the founders and co-founders of Electronium, of Zilliqa, it's great to see what they're doing in the world. So it's things like that as well, you know. And so that's where I'm seeing things out at the moment. Sure. Yeah.
So true. It helps humanity as well, right? Micropayments, these Definitely. Payment rails yeah. and stuff like
and
that.
And one thing I'd say as well is I think a lot of people forget it's called cryptocurrency, right? We need to actually realize it's supposed to be a currency. We're supposed to be able to do things with it. I mean, obviously, some have different types of use cases, but at the end of the day, it's got to have a use case. Otherwise, there is not really a value to
it. I read an article the other day that said Bitcoin was the sixth largest currency in the world. Yeah, so that's a big
that's a big title
thing,
so especially considering 99% of people haven't even heard of it. So
it's interesting to see where things are going to go. Definitely
That's fascinating. I really like those ideas, because exchange tokens and that asset class is so interesting, because you know, in the crypto winter, as you guys were mentioning, because of the fundamentals, even when there's a bear market, people still trade, people still buy the dip. So as long as the fundamentals are very strong, the token will do very well. And I remember in 2017 to all the way to 2019, the crypto winter, BNB, CRO, Hobi token, all these completely outperformed Bitcoin.
Definitely.
And why? It's because it doesn't matter if there's a bear market or not, as long as people use exchanges, that actually funds the token. Yeah. They performed really well.
Yeah, it was a no-brainer for me. I think when Binance Coin first came out, but when it was, it started getting a bit more traction, I just realized, oh, wait, hang on, you can buy a coin that represents the exchange. That's a no-brainer for me, because if I think the exchange is going to do well, why would it? It's essentially like, I mean, not quite, but like buying stock in it, right? You're believing in the exchange doing well, so you're going to buy shares.
It's the same thing with the price action of KuCoin shares when that came out. That was interesting to see how that cryptocurrency.
I think that was the most profitable one for me. Like, KuCoin shares has made
unbelievable.
Made me
money.
So,
that was one of the another teary, teary moments. I love my job.
Yeah.
That is really, really fascinating. So we talked about asset classes, sub-asset classes. Are you guys kind of into this DeFi thing, or is it too risky for you? How do you guys feel about it overall?
For me, certainly in the crypto market, everything is very cyclical and everything will have their hype. So we've had CryptoKitties. That was the hype about that. The decentralized exchanges at one point, and then also the exchange tokens, that had a lot of hype. And so even though some of these things are fundamentally good, Maybe the crypto kitties, I'm not too sure. but
NFTs,
DeFi itself is fundamentally good. And so, but the other side to that is that it has a lot of hype at the moment. So you're getting a lot of sharks, a lot of people in the Wild West trying to take advantage of that hype. And it's sad to sometimes see that being taken advantage of, because DeFi is fundamentally very good. To see that happen.
Yeah.
But I do think it is a very good thing. But I think the hype needs to die down just a little bit and for people to really harness and take advantage of what's
going on. No, because I think people are kind of missing the point of what is good about DeFi. I think a token will now say, we're DeFi, and then suddenly you see the price.
Exactly. Yeah.
Like, at the end of the day, you could say you're DeFi, but who cares unless you're actually doing something good. I think DeFi is definitely necessary and a good step for cryptocurrency, blockchain and all that. But I think if you can't prove how you're going to use it, how you're going to better your project with it, then just jumping on the trend as a project, I don't think is the best way to go about it. And also, as an investor, you should want to know more about how is DeFi actually going to help this? Like, should this even be DeFi?
And that's where we also that's where we do the deep dives into crypto. We really make sure that we use our time well to look into a project. So if a project does say, hey, we're DeFi, it's like, okay, cool. What else are you doing? How are you using that DeFi and everything like that? So it's really doing a deep dive into it. Look at the detail. And I think that's what separates us from a lot of people, is that we look into the detail, look into the white papers, light papers, the team. So I think that's a big thing.
And also I think a lot of YouTube, that's slightly bigger people on YouTube, have a lot of research behind them. It's just us at the moment. So it does take up a lot of time, but it is definitely worth it so far. I mean, maybe in the future, if we get bigger, then we can bring some people on board. But right now, it does take a lot of time,
just
but it's worth
on top
it.
Of that, though, we talk about sort of things, what we want to do in the future. I mean, we're looking to expand. I mean, CryptoBusy is the YouTube channel. We love doing that, but it's not going to be just that. We want to make sure that we want to expand and branch out into doing crypto events. If we did sort of a Netflix show,
that'd be awesome.
That'd be great. Talking about cryptocurrency and really spreading the word of cryptocurrency to the world and the use case it has, so it's things like that. We're looking to expand and we're looking to branch
and maybe
out
going to
things.
The countries where you do have a lot of unbanked people and spreading the word about these currencies that can help people. I think that'd be great from an ethical standpoint as well.
there's not enough coverage on that. Definitely. We don't know really what's going on. I mean, we see some images and some cool, we hear some cool stories, but you're right.
Yeah, and the projects that are doing so well at that, like you said, Electronium, they're criminally undervalued. And we always say this on our channel, but it seems people just want the next big thing and they don't realize, hang on, you got to find something that's actually got a real world use case, turning over profit maybe, or like, you know, a non-profit or something like that. Something that's actually doing well and you can actually see tangible results rather than just promises that might never come.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, the crypto market fails, the price of the coins and tokens does not reflect the value of the project as much as it does the stocks, right?
Yes.
So I think that's the problem. It's still very speculative, unfortunately.
I mean, I guess you have some examples, like with Tesla going up so much as a stock. People, I mean, even Elon Musk himself said, I think it's too high, and then you saw the price go down again. Stocks do reflect how the business does, because you have earnings reports. Yeah. You have all these kind of fundamental aspects that come out. Investors see that and they're like, okay, I'm going to put some money into this.
This is undervalued.
But with cryptocurrency, it doesn't seem to be like that at all. It seems like people will come out with, you know, news article after news article saying, look at all this cool stuff we're doing, and it's really good stuff. No one cares. Why not? That's what I understand.
That's a good point there. I mean, you know, as you said, you know, cryptocurrency companies will release, you know, their quarterly returns, and that does nothing to the price whatsoever. Yeah. They may just, you know, go up or down a little bit, but you know, it does nothing much to the price compared to if it were, you know, Tesla stock or Apple stock, and how that so that is, can be a misconception of saying this is a large number, therefore this is good.
Yeah.
You know, so it is trying to separate the two together.
It's really cool that we're comparing these markets. You guys compared FX with crypto, and then also the equities and stock market, which is really interesting. And I'd love to ask you guys, you know, it's a really simple question, but you know, many people think, oh, this guy's a trader and this guy's an investor, but most of the time it's a ratio, right? Within our portfolio.
Definitely.
I'd love to ask you guys, like, what are the two caps that you play? Can you tell us a few tips of you as an investor, and then change caps and tell us a few tips of you as a trader?
Sure. Yeah. So for me, I'd say I probably trade a little bit more than you, more kind of long term. Yeah. I mean, I'm still long term, but less so. So for me, I like to split up my portfolio in terms of, I'll have liquid capital that will be held in either USDT, Ethereum, Bitcoin, that I can play around with, trade with. And maybe that's 20 or 30% over the overall. And then of that, you know, 70, 80% left over, then that is what it's split up between the coins we mentioned earlier and whatever. But with the trading capital, I definitely would say don't just throw it all in one trade. You've got to, you know, like we said, risk management.
Yeah.
I would never risk more than 1% of my overall kind of 30% there in one trade. Otherwise, you're just asking for, like, you might be able to make way more, but it's not worth it when you realize you could lose it all.
For me, myself, you know, as I see myself more of an investor long term. You know, when I was younger, I did more, you know, day trading and everything like that. And I did find it was profitable at some points, but also, you know, you could look at your daily routine. And so for me, being an investor sort of, or, you know, swing trading over a longer period of time, so maybe holding trades for a month up to a year, maybe even longer than that, that fits in with my routine. So, you know, when you look into something that's for long term, you've really got to go deep into the fundamentals, into, again, as I said, you know, the white paper, look at the team, what are they doing? And, you know, quarterly, annual reports, things like that. So I'd say, okay, so a tip would be, it would be looking at your risk management. And as you always say, you know, don't invest or trade more than you're willing to lose.
And
that's I know it's said a lot, but it is a big, big thing. Because you see a lot of people out there that do get blindsided by the whole you know, Lamborghini or the nice house or everything like that. And they just put everything into one trade or everything into one you know, asset or everything like that. And they're not looking at the longer term perspective. So I'd say another tip would be, have a longer term perspective about this.
Yeah.
It's not just going to be, you know, tomorrow or next week. It's not a marathon. It's the other way around. It's not a sprint, it's a marathon. And so that's the way to look at it. And that's definitely been helpful for me.
And I think another thing in general, I know we're talking about cryptocurrency in general, but I think diversification across the board is really key. I mean, we have a lot of interactions day by day in our Telegram group, on our YouTube channel, from like probably tens, hundreds of people every couple of weeks saying, look, I've just taken my pension out early, should I put it all in crypto, I'm going to remortgage my house. We're like, no, don't do that. And like, you need to have backup plans. You know, we all believe crypto is going to do well. That's why we're here. But at the same time, you do have to have things to fall back on. You know, we do have a percentage of our overall wealth in cryptocurrency, but we also have you know, stocks. We also have, we trade capital in Forex. We also look into property, like all that kind of stuff. I think you need, as long as you can, you know, afford it and you can do it, I think diversification is key across the board, definitely. And then you can afford to take more risk in crypto because you're already backed up in other places.
That's really good. Really, really good tips. And just to end this, it's been so far such an amazing, you guys really feed off each other so well. It's so cool. I can see that you guys were born in the same hospital. I can see it already through the tunnel. But I'd love to ask you guys about technical analysis.
Yes.
And we're kind of asking everybody, like, besides, you know, key support, key resistance, like, what are some technical indicators that have helped you trade recently in crypto and that you find quite interesting?
Sure. Yeah. So for me, I'm mainly a price action trader. So for the majority of my analysis that you can see on the channel, it's mostly, you know, trend lines. I don't, support and resistance is key, but at the same time, you can get like just patterns in general. You have like certain candlestick patterns that you just, it takes a long time to learn, but once you've been doing it for as long as we have, for example, you can kind of just recognize it. There are certain, like, you know, you can see certain momentum happening, and there's just a lot of different factors. There is one indicator that I mean, I use it occasionally when I do use indicators. It's called the SSL channel. And for me, that has been the most profitable indicator across all markets by far. I mean, you can't just, it's not just a buy when it says buy, so on. It's not as simple as that, but you can utilize it to identify trends. So for me, the most profitable way I've traded is you take up a higher time frame. So let's say you're looking for an intraday trade. So you're looking at the 4-hour chart to identify the overall trend, and then maybe I'll look at the 15-minute chart to trade on. So the 4-hour chart, I'll put up the SSL channel, and that will tell me, is it in an uptrend or is it in a downtrend? It's made up of two lines. So it's a green line and a red line. And if the green line's on top, it's an uptrend. The green, red line's on top, then it's a downtrend. And I'll literally go on that. So if it's telling me it's in an uptrend on the 4-hour, I will not even look to take a short trade on the 15-minute, if we're talking about margin trading, for example. Or if it's in a downtrend on the 4-hour, I won't even try to buy it, because I just know that's against the overall trend of the market. So using that multiple time frame confluence, that is huge. And using the SSL indicator on that higher time frame to give you an idea of the trend, and then you take trades based on your other indicators or plans. So maybe, for example, a good setup might be you have the SSL channel on the higher time frame, the 4-hour time frame, and then maybe use a 50 exponential moving average on the 15-minute time frame. And you could say if it's in an uptrend on the 4-hour, then you can wait for it to break out from the 50 EMA, retest, buy the retest, and then that could be an idea. It's not going to work every time, nothing will, but at the end of the day, it's been pretty profitable, that type of thing for me. So definitely that's a good nugget there.
Fascinating. Thanks for all the details. Yeah, that's
and
great.
So for myself, you know, on the longer term side of things, I go into the weekly, sometimes the monthly, and the daily time frame. And I do also use the exponential moving averages. I look at the 200, the 100, and the 50. And so they are independent to each other. But if on paper, if the candlesticks close above any of the lines, that it, then on paper it is bullish. And if they close below the lines, then they are bearish. And you know, the further they close up, so above each one, the more it is either way. But that's just on paper. You know, we have to take into account the fundamentals as well. But that's one thing. So we talked about support and resistance lines. I find them quite helpful for myself to when I want to construct a you know, a trade for either a long or a short, and see what the profit and the risk and everything would be on that. So you know, I'll go on to the monthly or the weekly. I'll go monthly, the weekly, the daily. And then I identify key areas of support and resistance on each one. I put a different color for each time frame. So then when I go down onto the daily, which I mainly use, incorporate the exponential moving averages and seeing where the key areas of support and resistance are from the different time frames. And then take that all into account. And then from there, I can create my trade. Definitely. And that's how I.
And I'd say another really good potential strategy that you could try out is it's just a break and retest, which is basically, so crypto does this great thing compared to other markets, is the trends are just way longer and kind of faster moving than other markets in general. And so usually when a coin breaks out, it's not just going to break out and then come back down. It's going to break out and keep going. And the way you can get in, so people think that sometimes, oh, when the breakout's already happened, I've missed the move. That's just the beginning. You want to wait for the pullback. And then what you can do is you can mark out the previous resistance and then it will become support potentially. So you wait for the break, you wait for the retest, and then you buy again. You can use, like you said, moving averages to help you if you want. I personally just use price action, but it's whatever kind of fits for you and your style of trading, I guess.
No, that's really well said. I think Carl Moon does exactly that on his channel, right? He talks about, you know, when resistance becomes support, and that's where he goes for a big, you know, when he sees that uptrend, he goes for a big trade there, right? And takes profits after.
Definitely. And then there are patterns as well. So for example, if the resistance has become support and then you see a double bottom, even more, or triple bottom, then that's when you're looking for the kind of the big winners there, because you know that. And then sometimes what a lot of people I've noticed don't actually do is you can set kind of a buy stop order. So this isn't just an order where you're getting into the market as soon as at the current price. This is where you say, okay, at this price, I want you to take me into the trade. Now this might be, you know, you're not going to get as much profit because you might be setting your buy stop above a certain area, so you're missing out on the first bit of the move. But that guarantees you're in with momentum. So as the market's moving up, that's when you're getting in and you can ride that momentum rather than waiting for it to consolidate and then break out. So,
and all of these things that we've mentioned has helped us a lot, tremendously, in over the past year, 2 years. And again, as we've said, you know, it's forever changing, always learning, and it's a process. At the end of the day, it's a journey. So,
fantastically said, guys. And the last question I need to ask you is, obviously today we noticed a big correction, right?
Yeah.
And also, you know, in terms of stock markets and even crypto, in stock markets, apparently 80% of trades go through trading bots, right? And crypto, the crypto sphere as well, clearly you can see trading bots are involved because once Bitcoin crashes, the other the rest of the other assets also crash with Bitcoin, the mothership other tiny boats. But do you guys still see personal trading as a job in the future, or is it going to be more investors and mainly people just programming their trading bots? And personally, how do you see things evolve?
Personally, I do think that there will still be, you know, the personal traders, just like, you know, when I was talking earlier about the idea that we're going into the next industrial revolution with new technology like AI. A lot of people are saying that AI is going to get rid of lawyers. I don't think it's going to be the case. I think it's going to help lawyers a lot easier. I think it's going to be the same with traders. I think it's going to make their jobs a lot easier. And, you know, yes, there'll be a lot of people using bots and let the bot do the trade itself. But there's, at the end of the day, there's something fun about doing it yourself and getting involved with it yourself.
That's what I was going to say. I definitely love it way too much to ever stop. It's one of those things I feel like I'll be 80 and still placing trades. But I'm just so addicted to it. It's really fun. And at the end of the day, it's, you know, if it's making you money, then why would you stop? Now, bots, in one way, they are way better because they don't have that emotion. And as we mentioned earlier, emotion is the biggest killer of profits in all markets. You know, if you get emotional, you're going to take the trade out too early, you're going to take it out for a loss, you're going to double down on your loss, and that's the worst thing you can do. So a bot has no emotion, so it can just execute the trade to the plan, to the strategy, and there'll be no kind of room for error there, human error. But at the same time, it does take the enjoyment out a little bit. So maybe it's useful. And also the bot's not going to necessarily have all that kind of experience, because for me, yes, I have a strategy, but also because I've seen so much of the markets move, I know which setups might be slightly better on a discretionary basis, which I couldn't really, as far as I know, that you can program that into a bot based on like prior knowledge that you just have from seeing all these different markets. So I think there's definitely something to be said about using it alongside, in conjunction with it, with yourself. But I would rather trade myself than let something else do it for me.
So I think, you know, robots and bots, you know, they're attractive, and you know, it's like, oh, just be automatic and let it do its thing. But at the end of the day, you know, why did you get into trading into the first place? You know, you don't get to get into something and then forget about it and let someone else do it, or let something else do it. You know, you want to get it and get involved with yourself and have discipline and motivation. And I think, you know, from what we've been doing, we still have the motivation, and I think we'll always have the motivation for that. And if you get a bot involved and let that take over 24/7, you're going to lose that motivation over the longer period of time. So have it there to assist you when it's needed, but you know, also get involved.
I feel like it's with self-driving cars, for example. They'll probably be the future, but also you're going to have a lot of people that love driving, right? And those people that love driving might be a bit upset, and That's why you still have a lot of people that drive manual, even though they're automatic cars. They just love the feel.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, me too. I love it. That's the thing.
Like, you know, you can essentially make things easier. You can even automate things completely. But at the end of the day, there's going to be those people that have that true love for it and want to get more in tune with it.
It's the same with music as well. You know, everything's digital. It's on Spotify, but also vinyl is so popular.
Yeah, that's pretty retro as well. That kind of nostalgia as well.
Yeah, that is so true. That's really, really fascinating. I hadn't thought about it from that angle. And just one last question. I know I always say one last question. It's been already 20 questions. But you just mentioned emotions and you also mentioned strategy and plan. Is that the number one way to get rid of emotions? Because I feel like emotions is like the suicidal thing in trading.
Definitely.
That FOMO and FUDDing is really where you're going to get absolutely murked, right?
Have a plan.
Have a plan.
Have a checklist.
Have a checklist.
And stick to it.
Stick to it.
It's literally just this train discipline. You'll learn it over time as well. And at the end of the day, losses can help. Like we said before, the more you lose, the more you're going to realize, I need to stop not following my trading plan. And set up some kind of forfeit that you have to do if you don't follow your rules. Or there's an alarm clock that people have, which is in the form of weighing scales. And they put it by the end of your bed. And the only way you can turn the alarm off is if you put your full weight on it. So you have to probably be out of bed. You can't just snooze it, right? If you don't wake up in time, and if you don't put your full weight on it, then every like 5 minutes it donates £5 to a charity or something like that. So, you know, it's good for the charity, but at the same time, you're losing money by not waking up. So it's an extra motivator there, you know.
Yeah, to make sure that you're fully.
So you need to follow your plan. And I think the same type of thing there. If you set a forfeit, you don't want to do the forfeit, then you're going to try even harder to stick to your plan. And at the end of the day, having a rigid plan is how you're going to find success.
And that does take the emotion out of it.
Yeah, it takes the emotion out.
It's easiest to get tied up into the emotion itself. So. Yeah. You have to be so unbiased about it.
Definitely.
It's really hard. I think controlling emotions is probably the most difficult task, right?
Yeah. And also not getting married to a position, right? If you say you love a coin, but it's just going down and down, sometimes you just need to know when to call it quits. Or same with a trade, for example. If a trade is just going down, you know like it is going to hit my stop loss. Don't just let it hit your stop loss. Just cut it early. You cut the losers and let the winners ride, is the saying. And I think that is definitely key.
And hopefully a lot of people learned that after the big correction, of 2018, right? Exactly. Exactly. Where we all took a big beating.
Right? Definitely.
This was fascinating, gentlemen. It was so cool. And the vibe that you guys give with each other is just really cool. It reminds me of me and my best friend that don't see each other anymore. but it was really, really nice. And definitely for those guys watching out there, CryptoBusy is a really, really high quality channel. Anything else that you guys want to share with the community before we go? Obviously, you have the YouTube channel.
YouTube channel, which
is killer.
Telegram. Twitter. Instagram.
Yeah, make sure to follow us on Twitter.
We've also got a group that we have where we share some of our trades. It's over on Patreon. But yeah, we got a ton of different things. Check it out for sure.
Yeah, really, really upcoming. One of the biggest and the fastest scaling channels in the crypto sphere as of today. So don't forget to check it out. And guys, if you like this show, don't forget to comment, like, but also blast that bell notification so that you can get access to these timeless interviews shot here in a friendly atmosphere. Join us every Wednesday, premiering at a PC near you, 8 o'clock UK time. See you next week, guys.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.